Welcome everyone to this recording. If you're wondering, how am I doing? Well, I'm wondering how you're all doing. I am hanging in there. And it's very interesting right now. And but I'm doing great. I'm doing great. And of course, making huge efforts. Greater efforts are coming. So I want you to hang in there as well. Miracles are coming. Miracles. I just had a big one. A huge one. And maybe I just let it sink in. People are talking. We're aware that something is coming, that a shift is coming. And I have a perspective on it. And it's a wonderful perspective. It's been validated. But first, let's acknowledge that those of you who are feeling that, wow, the equilibrium has suddenly changed and something, the balance has shifted. This is right on track, right on track. And there is a way. Those whose business it is to help us are very much aware of what's going on. Okay? The grace of God is entirely in control and present for us, for those who want help from it. Now, some don't want to be helped in that way. And this is their adventure. Okay? We don't judge them for their adventure. They're absolutely free to turn their backs on reality and pretend it doesn't exist, and pretend that reality pretend that pretension has a separate cause of it. This is really the key. We're pretending, we're walking down a road nice and briskly, limber, and then we say, oh, I feel like pretending like I'm crippled and I have to struggle along, drag my legs and like an old person, crippled person. And we start doing that just for fun. We say, you know, I'm just showing how limber I am. I could even pretend to be crippled. And then we start thinking, wait a minute, this crippledness is coming from some other power. It's not coming from my pretension. It's coming from some other power. I don't know how to get free of it. Help, help, God, help, help. I don't know how to get free of it. And then, you see, we're in this trap of not being aware of that we're the ones who are doing the pretending. So we can do that if we want to. And many are choosing to do that. Okay, this is fine. And they won't be helpful. I played golf with a couple of two Japanese men. And the whole time, they never helped me look for my golf ball. Never helped me in any way. And yet I put tremendous effort into helping them, searching for their golf balls, you know, trying to find it, trying to help them. Never lifted a finger to help me. I noticed that. I said, that's very odd. And indeed. And so, different people are going to be different, right? Some will choose a path, a certain path, and others will choose another. But the paths are very simple. It's either you're on the path of realizing that you're the one doing the pretending. Nothing's doing the pretending for you. You're doing the pretending. We are the ones who are pretending. There's no force, external force, that is pretending for us. Not really. We've done a great job of trying to pretend there is, but there isn't. This is all the teachers are telling us. That's it. So if we want to get to that, get to the root of that, and see this and then have a good laugh at it, then that's one path. The other is that they don't want to get to the root of it. Not yet. Which is fine. That's their path. It's their adventure. It's their grand, having a grand adventure. And they don't really want to get to the root of it. They still think it's external. They just want to somehow adapt better to the so-called external pretension. Okay. All right, that's just a path. Here, we are very keen on recognizing we're the ones doing the pretending. Now, there's this old Indian lady in the neighborhood, very conservative, you know, dressed in very conservative, old school, and she takes walks, and I've seen her, and she's just staring straight ahead and very serious, trying to keep her balance probably, and culturally too, isolated here. And I was on a run, and I saw her coming down right at the foot of this hill. And I was going up the hill, I went right past her. I sort of smiled at her, look, but she's staring straight ahead. And no contact. I said, wow. Okay, what is that? Now, today, I get up, I leave, I'm driving. And there she is crossing this road, right in front of me. And she has to look up because she was crossing a road and she's looking, where's the traffic coming from? And so she looks up at my vehicle and sees me. And I raise my hand up to her and I smile right at her. And she looks right at me and she raises her hand and she smiles right at me. Beautiful smile. Holy cow. Contact. Made a huge impression upon me. It's very, very, very powerful foreshadowing here. I get very mad at Ananda Mahima, for instance, because I know she can help us. she has it. I say, what, you know, come on, what are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? It's a massacre coming. What are you waiting for? I get so irritated. But, you know, they know what they're doing. They know the timing of things. So when it's right to make contact, contact is made. We need help in downsizing our expectations and playing it safe and dropping our ambitions and such. Our ambitions are to fashion an external cause for our pretension. That's what our ambition is wrapped up in, actually. We don't realize that. We think, no, this is all true, and we're just trying to make it better. But there's no truth to it whatsoever. And things are going to get worse than we realize. This is the key. I've hammered on this ceaselessly my whole life. Circumstances are going to get worse than we realize. And so we have to take a precautionary step because of that, so we don't get brutalized by it. No matter how smart we think we are, it's going to be worse than we realize. And that was highlighted by going out and playing golf, and the pro shop guy says, just stay out of the bunkers. That's all he says, stay out of them. And I said, well, okay, maybe some are bad, maybe some are not so bad. Well, they were all full of water. Okay, they were all full of water. They were all terrible. So I'd hit into one. I'd say, well, I think I'm fine. I go there. It's a lake. My ball's lost. And I didn't get it. I kept thinking it's not that bad. So it was worse than I could consider. My mind was not able to grasp how bad it was, actually. This is the problem we're facing. Our minds are not going to be able to grasp how bad it's going to get here. And we just have to accept that fact. Because what we mean of our mind is our ambition. So we don't realize how there are those who are extremely ambitious and their plans are such that it's going to shock us and we're in over our heads. So we need to back off. We need to back off our ambition and feel okay about that. And this is what the teachers help us with. Reduced intensity zone means reduced intensity of our ambition, our arrogance, our absurdity. It's all one thing: arrogance, absurdity, ambition. To try to create some other cause other than God. And a truck goes by on the side. We deliver. So we need to be delivered from this situation right now. It's going to be worse than we can imagine. And so we don't have the skill sets to handle it. We don't have the right habits to handle it. I don't care who you are, you don't have the right habits to handle what's coming. So you need to start working on some other habits. Just start working on new habits. And the old habits say that they're wonderful. Thank you, old habits. But I know right now I need to focus on some new habits. And it's really that simple. Now here, we need not panic. We are on the right track. There's no question about it. So even though we may not be able to express it eloquently every moment because of the great shifts that are taking place, that's okay. It's okay. It's in our hearts. It's in our clarity. It's in the core of our being. What we need to do is to shift to a new set of habits. The old habits won't work anymore. The problem is we keep trying to integrate the old habits with new habits, and that's not going to work. That is not going to work. We have to start working on a new set of habits and have faith in those new set of habits. It's essential. It is essential. It is essential. Lower our expectations of our ambition. What we're getting is a reflection of our own ambition coming back to us in amplified form in this world. And it's saying, this is what you must engage with now. But we can choose to say no. I'm not interested. Maybe another lifetime I'll engage with this, but not now. So it's a very different set of habits to say, I'm going to just take a break from ambition. All ambition. Just sit quietly. This is the key. The key practice is sitting quietly. I'm doing these videos, slideshow videos now. Fairly long ones, a couple hours. Some maybe get even longer than that. Coming up. And just sit and watch. Be patient, be calm. You see, the old style was less ambitious, more conservative. Let's just be grateful for what we have. Let's not be overly ambitious. Let's not try to do too much. It's like that. And then you have time to say, and then your attention is able to rest upon true teaching, really. Or let's say, teaching that clarifies the truth for us, that this is all what we're doing is we're pretending. Some call it dreaming. I call it pretending. I feel that's a little more to the point. Now, the mistake that everyone here is tending to make, just like that was pointed out to me on the golf course, is I thought my old habits were pretty good. And I said, well, I think I can use my old habits. I just have to use them in a smart way. No, the old habits won't work. The habits we're used to won't work anymore here in terms of peace of mind. Our old habits are being exploited. Okay, so when I said I'm going to put all my old habits, everything, all my garbage into the future life, this is when I got this shout of anger and exasperation from the ego, from the egoic complex. It says, you can't do that, because that freed me from what they were doing, which is exploiting our old habits, exploiting what our psychology, our habits, our belief system. So by putting all that in the future, I'm not going to engage that now. That's the key. That's the key. That liberates us from exploitation. Terrible exploitation, actually. And if I could be liberated from this traffic jam, traffic gridlock here. I thought I left late enough to be not run into this, but did not. Anyway, beautiful day here. Break between storms. We have to be willing to start practicing a new set of habits with a new premise to them. We can't keep the old premise and just keep trying to perfect our habits based on that old premise. This does not work. This is the trouble. So when I was playing golf, I said, well, I'm used to, I can handle this hole here. I can do this. I'm used to this. No, it didn't work. It didn't work. So I have to come up with I had a game plan. I didn't follow it because my old habits kept saying, no. I can perfect my old habits. So now I'm saying, no, next time I am going to just say, this is how I'm going to play it. And I'm going to take a new strategy. And I'm going to stick to it. And it's very difficult. I was kicking myself. I was laughing, actually. I said, oh, my gosh. I said, don't play it safer. Play it off to the right here. I said, but I've never done that. You know, that's not a powerful move to do. Come on, I've got more power than that. I said, no. Not right now. I can hit her over that lake. No. It's not going to work well for you. It didn't work well. I should have played it safe. So the old habits keep trying to assert themselves. And what I find in people is they're still thinking that there's a way to make those old habits work for them properly. And this is why in politics that shows up. And people are still looking for political solutions. And the song Running Out of Time, which I did back in 1998 or so, 99, I highlighted this. I said, we don't need a political solution. What we need is a heavenly infusion. Something like that. Political solutions are old habits. We've kept trying to solve our problems politically through some form of governance. And this is an old habit. This is being exploited. All the while, where this terrible trouble is coming upon us, people are still engrossed in politics. Well, the Holy Spirit told me, boycott politics. And I did. People are still caught in it very badly. That politics is not going to work anymore. It's simply distracting us from the exploitation that is to come. So diversions. I'm boycotting sports. Somebody told me the Warriors set the all-time, home winning streak record of 45. This is a huge thing for the pride of Bay Area sports, and it was getting close to that. I think it was at like 42, 41 when the Holy Spirit told me I have to boycott sports, and I said, "Wow, what a time to have to do that!" Because this is like a huge story to beat the Chicago Bulls and Michael Jordan's record. It's just an amazing accomplishment for them. Historic accomplishment. And yet, I boycotted it. I haven't been following it at all. I wasn't even unaware. They told me, oh, did you know that the Warriors did? I said, wow, really? That's amazing. And then I went right back to my Ramanaharshi slideshow, right? So I wasn't pulled off track by this. And so the Holy Spirit, of course, is right again telling me this. Now's the time to boycott this. Now's the time to boycott this. You need to do that. Now's the time to change your strategy out on the golf course. And I said, oh, okay, I got to do it. Let the Holy Spirit be your caddy. And I wasn't listening to my caddy. And it's real difficult to realize you don't have the power that you thought you used to have. You don't have the influence you used to have. Not here. So we need a new set of habits. And it's not how to adjust to exploitation. It's how to put all possibility of exploitation into a future life. And in this life here now, there's not even the possibility of that at all. That you're completely stable and peaceful, and nothing can disturb it at all. You cannot be exploited. There's no psychology, there's no ambition to exploit. And this is what the ego is so frightened of. It wants you to react. It needs for you to react. Okay, it needs for you to believe in the power of pretension. As the great teachers tell us, nothing has ever happened here. Nothing's happening, and nothing has ever happened, actually. And there's nothing the ego can do about that. Okay. So we have to realize we are in a crisis, big time crisis right now, worst crisis ever on this planet. No matter how bad we think it will be, it's going to be worse. Psychologically, we don't understand the cleverness of this trap, and no matter how much we think we understand it, we don't understand it. It's our own creativity coming to bite us. Think about that. Consider that. And realize that there's no way that we can adequately define it. And so we have to sidestep it. Now what happens is, when you start playing it safe, very conservative, very cautious, very safe, you begin to gain confidence again, and you start to say, okay, I'm okay, I'm okay. I've had this happen before, like on a golf course when I'm getting beat up. I'm starting to play just real safe. Like I said, let me just be ridiculously safe here. I'm not going to risk this, risk that. And so I begin to, there's no struggle then. The ball's in a nice place. I come up, hit it again. It's another nice place, and everything seems okay. Well, my score, you know, is may not be great, but I feel okay. There's no struggle taking place. I'm not hitting it into lakes, you know, and losing balls and all this stuff. And so you feel, oh, I'm not losing my golf ball at all. I'm hitting it nicely. It goes where I want it to go. Great. I'm just lowering my expectations. And then I recover confidence in myself. And at that point, the whole perspective shifts. And you say, you know, it's not so tough out here. It's amazing how taking a step back or sidestepping something for a while, how that can recenter us. We become recentered. What's coming upon the world is an attempt to establish a false center of being. And it's the most ambitious effort ever. So, simply listen to those who have accepted the true center of being and do what they suggest. Listen to the caddy, and the Holy Spirit says, you know, sidestep this. You don't realize how virulent it is. It's a virulency that we are unprepared for, and there's no purpose to struggle with it. The wisdom is to say, I'll deal with that in another life. Okay, because all it is our ambition to establish a new center of being, which is causing this pretense. In other words, just trying to make the pretense real. So we will engage with, quote unquote, the adversary, some other future life, distant life, not this one. This one we will decide to be centered in true being, okay, the one true being. And if there's some great adversary of that, and we want to engage in this notion of we need to defeat some great adversary, we'll do that another life. Here we will simply abide in the realization that God has no opposite. God has no adversary. Now, many, well, of course, that's immature. That the mature viewpoint is to realize there is an adversary, and our job is to defeat it. That's what they will say. Of course they will say it. I say, well, we will entertain that viewpoint also of supposed immaturity. We'll also entertain that in a future life. Okay, we're not going to entertain that here. Now, this is what gets the ego real mad. But all it can do is yelp in a very, you know, an outraged dignity. It's just dignity. Its authority has been outraged by this. Yeah, so be it. You know, we'll deal with that outraged authority in a future life if we decide to. So the new habits is just put attention on our on the true center of being, the one center of being. Be centered, putting emphasis on being centered in being, original being. And the issue of whether we're supposed to fashion a new center of being is left to a future life at this point. And if we need habits to try and do that, we will pick those up at that point. And this issue of whether we're being regressive or whatever, we'll pick that issue up also at another point. Again, I highly advise, I'm doing this for those who are lazy. I'm making videos, slideshow videos, okay. And so, but this is helpful. We could sit there and keep in mind that we're trying to establish new habits. So we need to be enthusiastic about it and be determined. When we start an exercise program, remember how it feels, or a diet, we're so enthusiastic about it. And we're gung-ho, and that's great. You need that gung-ho-ness. That's why I always say that the successful baseball teams are the ones who bring up some rookies late in the year. They need some veterans or hungry veterans who have never won, and some rookies who are just gung-ho. And it gives a jolt of life and energy to the dugout and the team. Because here are these rookies, they just say, man, I am so glad to be here. I'm just all in, full effort on everything, just hustling, just bringing the enthusiasm. And the older veterans are kind of tired. They've been through it many times. They're like, wow. And that reminds them, oh, yeah, I used to be like this. And they start catching that enthusiasm bug. And they start laughing more and having a great time and said, wow, this is fun. I'm into this. This is what we need. So I'm making more videos. I have another one in the pipeline of Ramana Maharshi. You'll see them up there. I'll put a playlist there of all of Ramana Maharshi's videos that I've done. He's a big help. Okay. We don't have to say who the biggest help is. Okay. We don't. One of the new habits is we don't have to say that. All teachers are centered in true being. All true teachers have accepted their true beingness, the true beingness, which is God. All of them have. The ones that I'm putting forth. So, in reality, there's no differentiation at all. We're all perfectly free. All of us have the same perfect freedom. There's no one who has higher freedom than someone else. So there's no point in saying, well, who's the greatest teacher? Or what's the greatest? It's the greatest teaching is whatever is helping us right now. The this is how my flexibility views it. And it could be that what is most helpful right now for people happens to be one particular teacher. Or one practice, or one this, or one that. It's all good. Whatever is most helpful to us right now, that's the best teaching for us right now. We should not extrapolate into the future. In putting together the new Ramana Maharshi slideshow, I was struck by great insight, which I cannot quite elaborate upon at this point. Greater depth, more and more depth of recognition. A little different than the time before. Landscape has changed. But I have an open mind to what will be helpful. I don't have a closed mind saying, well, I already know what's going to be most helpful. I'm going to just shut my mind to everything else. I'd say I'm open to the greatest help possible today. However, whatever the form of that great help takes, it is not important to me. What's important is that it helps me get deeper towards acceptance. It's really, we talk about enlightenment. It's acceptance. And I was thinking, how can I help anyone? What kind of advice could I give them? If someone came to me and said, oh, you're enlightened. Can you help me be enlightened? You know, the truth of the matter is, this is really tough to take. Many of us want to be great teachers, meaning we want to help everybody as much as possible. But the truth is, there's nothing we can do other than reassure that it's an issue of curiosity. And if we're still curious in arrogance and pretense, if we're still curious about absurdity, about can we, what is this adventure, how will it turn out? If we're still curious about that, we will not drop it. We will not drop it. I don't care if there's a million enlightened teachers in the world. We will not drop it. The idea that if there's so many enlightened teachers, the 100th monkey, everybody starts switching over is simply not true. It is not true. It's our curiosity about pretense. And can we make a separate power? It's our curiosity about this that keeps us deluded. And we can wrap it up in all sorts of nice-sounding religious spiritual phrases and concepts. We can package it all, but we will not drop the arrogance and the absurdity. We will not drop it, and the curiosity and the pretense. We will not drop it. This is a fact. We will just be posers, spiritual posers. We can do that. It's only when we just don't really care anymore about that truth dawns upon us. It's just like there's nothing that can force truth upon us at all. There's no technique that can accomplish this for us at all. It's merely we're no longer interested in absurdity and arrogance and pretension. We're just no longer interested in it. That is the truth. This is the real truth. So people think that teachers can do something magical for them. No, the teachers can't do anything magical for anyone. They're just kind of like an audience that claps. When you do something good, they clap and applaud and kind of feel, okay. It's reassurance. But they can do nothing at all about our decision and our acceptance. We have absolute free will. Everyone has equal free will. So there aren't any of those who are more powerful than we are. It doesn't exist. The idea that you can find someone who's more powerful than you is impossible. The idea there's some teacher out there that is more powerful than you is absurdity. You will never find such a teacher who's more powerful than you. Each one of us has full power, always. We're just pretending to not have full power. That in no way removes full power from us, never. And this is what the teachers tell us. They say, hey, I'm not more powerful than you, and I'm aware of this. And you say, oh, come on, I want to get rid of something. What they're really saying is, oh, come on, believe that you're more powerful, which then means that there's less powerful, which it takes you right out of God awareness. It's a trick. Nobody is more powerful than anyone else. All of our experiencing is our own choice. We're entirely in charge of our experiencing. Everyone is. Everything is. Even the cows, the grass, whatever it is. There's only freedom. God only created freedom. That's it. Did not create the cows. Created freedom. So, so disinterest in how does this story of pretense, how does it turn out? You know, what are the twists and turns? And you can tell where your mind is at. I mean, it's not difficult, not that difficult. I was able to break away from all sports, especially this incredibly compelling run the Golden State Warriors are on. And just stop. Cold turkey. Which means I really don't care how it turns out. It's really not important to me. And I find it's not. I was happy. Oh, it's great. But then my mind was right back onto truth. It's not that important. I'm not really that interested. You can tell if people like dramas and theater and entertainments of, you know, stories like this. I don't. I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in how it turns out, how stuff turns out. Less and less and less and less interested. So, you know, what are some movies? I'm not interested in movies. Some sitcom. I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in how anything turns out. Because it's all pretense. Nothing ever leaves its own intrinsic spaciousness. So how can we say something turns out in a certain way? It doesn't, actually. So eventually we just get tired of our foolishness, of our absurdity. We're just tired of it, and we just really, we lose interest in it. And this, I have to say this, because I feel this is the highest truth, that the real key, and the only real key there is to the spiritual path, is you simply are losing interest in how stuff turns out, how this all turns out. You're just not interested anymore. And that's all it is. And of course, when you realize you're losing interest, then you become interested in truth, and you start paying attention to that. Yes, that is absolutely so. What's really happening is you're just losing interest in all of this. This silly silliness, this silly pretension. You're just not interested in people and lives and destiny and fate. You realize there is no destiny. There is no fate. This is all just absurdity. You know, how does absurdity turn out? Well, it turns out absurdly, of course. It just remains absurd. What happens to absurdity? We're all so interested in that. Well, I can tell you, it just remains absurd. That's all. And then we hear this, it's just like, wow. Now, I forgot all about the Warriors' pursuit of this record. I completely forgot about it. I really did. Amazing, huh? Because I was really into it. I was hoping that something's got to hold my interest in how things turn out. And this was holding my interest. But I dropped it and forgot all about it. Amazing. People that know me would be shocked. You know, I tell them I'm not paying attention. What? You? Are you kidding me? I can't believe it. I can't believe it. Because I had to pretend, that when you're in this world, you got to pretend you're still interested in how it turns out. Because everybody's here because they're obsessed with how absurdity turns out. And so if you're not interested, they think something's wrong with you. I mean, that you need help. So I don't want people being solicitous towards me. So I fake interest, you know, just have to fake a little interest in the world. Last thing you want is everyone of you acting solicitous towards you. That's just the worst. So it's worth it to me to pretend to be a little bit interested. Oh yeah, how they doing? You're doing the okay. So he's still interested. Okay, good. He's okay. People say, am I okay? I'm not sure, but are they okay? They're okay too. Okay, that reassures me. You know that. They're still interested in how things turn out because we're all kind of losing interest and they're getting nervous, like because we think, oh, this is a mandate from God that we figure out, we find out, we just how it turns out. And so we think, well, I can't drop this. I mean, no way, I can't drop this. That's super important. Of course, that's just make-believe, pretense, absurdity. And we have to tell ourselves this in order to keep absurdity going so we think we can find out how it turns out. There's no turnout. It doesn't turn out. We don't turn out of our intrinsic spaciousness. We never do. There is no turnout. And if you're hearing this, this will produce shockwaves in you. It's producing them in me right now. This is called the wow. This is called the wow. This is called the wow. So full stop in the wow here. Full stop in the wow. What is coming in the world is this, you might say, ultra-ambition. There are those who are ultra-ambitious, and they've been invited here to act as mentors to us, to be ultra-ambitious. We call them the reptilians. Zeta Reticulans work for them. They're very, extraterrestrials, actually. And we have invited them to showcase to us how to be ultra ambitious, because we feel this is the answer. This is how we establish a separate reality. We have to be ultra ambitious. We think the problem is we just haven't been ambitious enough. So here in comes this ultra ambition. They say, well, in order to be ultra ambitious, you need to change everything. You know, restructure the world. Put us in charge and we will teach you how to do it. What we fail to realize, of course, is they're so ultra ambitious. What they do is they enslave. So that you serve their ambition. That's what ultra ambition really means. And so it's a trap. Our ambition has trapped us. And unfortunately, this is what happens. So I've spent my life around those who have no ambition, such as Sri Sri Ananda Maimon. No ambition whatsoever. Nothing. Ram Maharshi, no ambition. Jesus, no ambition. Longchenpa, no ambition. None. And I say, you know, I prefer what them to these reptilian, ultra-ambitious ones. It's just simple. It's just a preference. I don't have to explain preference, do we? Not really. Whatever it is that a demand for explanation, just fill that word in the blank, okay? Of course, the ultra-ambitious won't accept this because their ambition is to subjugate everyone. Monitor, regulate, subjugate. No freedom for anyone. This is their ambition. They're trying to destroy freedom. Reality is freedom. They're trying to create a separate reality. It can't be a reality of freedom because that would be the same reality. So they're ultra ambitious in domination. They've hid this. They've hidden this by using women to smuggle in this ambition and this domination. I call it the yoga girl thing, the yoga girl trap. Because we don't associate women with ultra ambition, although we should, actually, but we don't. So they deceived us. It's the Eve trap also. We don't realize how ambitious Eve really is. She's very ambitious. She turns out to be the one who's ultra ambitious. And then Adam goes along with it. So we've been caught unawares. We don't realize where the ambition really is coming from here. And we look at men and say, oh, they're not, you know, that ambitious. You know, no, it's the women who are ultra ambitious. And they're the ones who have invited the reptilians here, actually. It's not really the men. Some, but the real invitation came from women. What we say is women, how our ambition expresses itself. It seems bifurcated, but it's really not. But from pragmatic terms, they're the ones who invited the reptilians here. They're the ones who hosted them. They said, don't worry. We'll find a way to integrate you into the world here. And of course, they felt that this is going to help them materially. It's going to help them satisfy their material ambitions and their comforts and their vanity. And the reptilians knew how to exploit this. So they said, like, hey, you know, you seem really ambitious, and it seems like you're not really meeting your ambitions, and it seems like maybe the men are too conservative, and they're holding you back. And if they weren't so doggone conservative and insisting on, well, this is good enough, you know, they're lacking ambition, is what the reptilians told the women. And the women said, yeah, I mean, I can't seem to motivate my man enough, you know, he's just not ambitious enough. And if he was, I would be living in better creature comforts and having vacations, better outlook. And the reptilian said, yeah, that's really too bad. I mean, just that wouldn't happen if we were in charge, I'll tell you that. And the women said, huh? I said, well, huh? And the women said, well, wait a minute now. I mean, you guys seem very ambitious. And they say, oh, we are. I mean, look at the advancements we have, the technology we have, all this stuff. And they said, wow, you guys are super ambitious. They said, yeah, we are, and we're amazing. And they said, well, I mean, is there any way you could help us out here? They said, no, we're not supposed to interfere. We're not supposed to help out, you know. We can't really interfere with, you know. And he said, huh. Women said, huh. Well, I mean, like, if we you know, asked you to help us? Could you help us down? They said, well, if you ask us, we could. Yeah. I mean, but we can't force anything upon you. Oh, no, 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 the woman said, no, we understand, we understand. We don't want you to force anything. But, I mean, if we could ask you to come in here and start helping us out, and you know, we need to, you know, advance. We're kind of stuck, you know. We're not, our ambition doesn't seem to be working properly here. It's just, we're not getting the results we want, we crave. So, I mean, if you could help us out a little bit, I mean, that'd be great. The reptilian said, well, really? You really want us to? They said, yeah. Huh. I said, well, we'll think about it. You know, we're happy to help advance civilization and progress and learning. And yeah, I mean, that's what we're here for. So, you know, if you give us the opportunity, we would be delighted to help out. And they would say, wow. And secretly they smile and said, wow, I've really helped. And they say, you know, my man is just lacking ambition, and he just doesn't realize what he's missing out on. But I'm going to get it for him anyway. That's how good of a woman I am. I'm going to get him. I'm going to help advance the world, even though he doesn't quite feel like he can do it. And he's going to really be thrilled to see it. It's the old Adam and Eve thing. Same old, same old. So without telling the men what they were doing, the women invited the reptilians into this world and said, help us out, help us out. They said, okay, all right, we can do that. That's our thing. That's our thing. The snake comes into the Garden of Eden, so to speak. Literally what happened here in this world, and you know, we could just like, wow, we didn't mean we got fooled again. Yeah. And the women didn't tell us, but they were so excited about how they're helping the world, they couldn't quite keep it a secret, and they did blab about it quite a bit. If you were looking for it, which I was, you would have found it. They most certainly blabbed about it. And the reptilians put a cap on that after a while. And some of the women too said, hey, look, you know, we don't want this information getting out. Might cause us some problems. I mean, what if stuff goes wrong? They'll blame us. So we can't admit that we're doing anything at all. Because, of course, you know, part of being a woman is avoiding blame. Avoiding blame in this world. Avoiding responsibility for stuff that goes wrong. Oh, I had nothing to do with it. I know what you're talking about. The French have a saying, cherchez la femme. I mean, if you can't solve, for detectives, if you just can't solve the crime, make sure you've accounted for the role of the woman in the situation here. Make sure you've accounted for that. It's a very, very, very ironclad principle that women are experts at dodging responsibility for what happens in this world. And so the blabbing about what they were doing, That was suppressed. That was repressed. That was brought to an end. And so then it's like, you know, a blackout on that. But for a while, they were bragging about it. They were so excited, and they said, you know, we're the ones who are really responsible for bringing this world into a wonderful new age. We're the ones who are doing it. And then that kind of settled down a little bit, but it's still percolating there, that is for sure. The age of ultra ambition. They most certainly are responsible for it. No doubt about it. You invite the reptilians into this world, and they came in. But of course, they knew what they were doing. They were deceiving Eve all along. They intend to enslave this world. Absolutely. Now, yesterday, the Holy Spirit gave me this great, great heads up and a metaphor. I was driving along this road and the traffic stopped. And I said, that's odd. There's no reason for the traffic to stop along this road. What happened? You know, and a car was stopped there with its emergency blinkers were blinking. And then there's a guy running around. I said, what's he doing? What's going on? And he jumped back in his car and started going, but slowly. I said, there's some debris in the road probably. Okay. I went past there. There's no debris. There's nothing. I said, this is okay, very odd situation. What is going on here? Then I caught sight of a dog. Just for a moment. I said, okay, that's weird. Why is that dog there? So this car continued going slowly, and we're all following him. Everyone's backed up. And then it starts going faster. And we say, okay, everything's fine. And so we finally went a long ways up to this intersection. And then this car went right through the red light. Just went right through it. I said, what in the heck? And it went down a hill. And then suddenly, he came back up the hill. He must have done a quick U-turn. And then he was disobeying all traffic laws. Okay. It was a yellow Dodge Charger with red rally stripes on it. And as he came up the hill, I suddenly saw this dog running. The dog darted in down another road, and the car followed it. I said, ah, okay. Somehow a dog got out of his car, and the dog is a runner, and it's running. And so he's going after the dog. So he pulls into this driveway, and then he moves around, goes back out, and here he comes again. And it was just absolutely weaving through traffic, going in the wrong lanes, going through traffic lights, stop signs, everything. He was after this dog. I said, what manner of dog is this? And then, as I was turning through this intersection, here comes the dog. And this dog was what we call a whippet. And if you know whippets, that dog is a runner. And this whippet came screaming through the intersection. Cars, I had to slam on my brakes. Cars are honking at me or honking at something. And, you know, the dog doesn't know about cars very easy, and cars are having to dodge it. And it was a really quite a situation. And this whippet is just taken off. And though these dogs, it's tough to keep up with them. And so here comes this car, Charger again, you know, trying to come through the intersection, trying to follow this dog around. I mean, good luck catching a whippet. And so tried to pinch me there. Merging. Amazing. What were they thinking? You just cannot. I was merging just the way you're supposed to merge beautifully, and suddenly this car just tries to pass me. That's unbelievable. And then they almost hit me and have to whip into the lane. That is just amazing. You cannot expect people to drive in a sane manner right now. So, we have this dog on the loose that's causing mayhem. Nobody can catch it, and the guy is just, you know, causing massive confusion. This guy says, I have to catch this dog. I have to catch this dog. I can't let it go. I can't let it. Now, I was thinking, maybe I should try to help. Something told me, no, let it go, let it go. This symbolized the chaos that's to come. And I was told, stay out of it. Don't go chasing after that dog. You're just going to be completely confused, frustrated. This guy was getting very flustered. He's going to get in an accident, cause a traffic accident, cause a snarl, cause all sorts of trouble. Because he's chasing after this dog. He's got to catch this dog. And he was fixated on it. He was so fixated on it that he just... It was causing all sorts of troubles and confusion. Very, very interesting. Dog meaning the opposite of God, for instance. Animal nature as opposed to divine spiritual nature. You know, pretense nature, false nature as opposed to true nature. And our attempt to get false nature back in line, back where we were used to having it, inside the car, okay, is our problem. Now the dog was happy being free, and the dog says, wow, this is fun, I'm just running is what I do. And so the dog had no intention of being caught. It was in just full flight mode. This is a metaphor for what's going to come in this world. The pretense nature and the ultra ambition of the reptilians. They have no intention of being caught and put back into our ways. The old ways, they call it, the less ambitious ways. We're not going to be able to get it back the way we want it to be. Nancy Reagan passing away was the final blow of the old regime. The old regime is gone. She was the last part of it. As far as being, I mean, she was an extremely significant factor in the old regime. The queen of the old regime. And now the queen is gone. That means changes are coming. Reptilians can make their move. She said to them, I'm the queen here, not you. Okay, so she said, just say no to the reptilians. I'm the queen. And now, so she's gone, and the reptilians have got things all set up for themselves. And the yoga girls think that they are the saviors of the world, and you're going to get this great, great admiration forever, you know, placed on a higher level than everyone else and stuff, and it isn't going to work that way, actually. They're in for a big surprise. And, of course, they're going to blame the men. So I'm not going to be around to be blamed for that. That's you know, it's a woman's prerogative to blame the man, basically, in this world. When stuff goes wrong, they can play the ingenue, you know, very, very well. Like, I didn't know what's going on. My baby, oh, gee, I have a baby. Oh, I have a child I got to take care of. Okay, see you later. Yeah. So I'm not going to be around. Don't be around to be blamed. Okay. This is very important. They're going to be really, 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 really upset. And things get completely snarled and troublesome here. Who's going to take the fall for it? Any guesses? It's going to be the guys, especially white males. They're set up to be the scapegoats. Absolutely set up to be the scapegoats here. No question about it. Everyone's already agreed. Yeah, what if we screw up? What if things go wrong? Oh, okay, who are we going to blame? Who are we going to blame? Of course they think about that. All along they think about that because they know they're screwing up. Deep down they say, wow, this could go wrong. I got a feeling. So it's the white males. Older white males are to blame for everything. So, but we're not going to be around to blame. Because the great spiritual teachers don't blame us. They understand what's happening. They know what's happening. Yeah, well, they're going to say, well, if you just helped us more, if you just more ambitious, we could have been on top. We could have got everything, all the stuff, and plus we could have gotten rid of the reptilians. We could have had our cake and eat it too. We could have this wonderful world. You just didn't get it. You know, it's your fault. You dragged your feet. You didn't respect us enough. You didn't empower us enough. You did blah 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 blah. You know, they just have this massive grievance thing that they're going to dump on us. That's right. But we're not going to be there for them to dump it on us. If you're wise, you won't be there to get dumped on. because they say, well, look, if we accept responsibility, you know, we won't be able to raise children, have children anymore, because we just will feel so disempowered. You know, it's just like we can't really pass that on any, we don't want to pass this feeling we have onto our children, so we're just going to stop having children, so we can't do that. You got to take the blame. It's always that way here. The men have to take the blame. It's been that way throughout history. And here and there, some men get tired of that. And they say, no, we're not going to be around to get dumped on like that. And then we're told, but that's your role. You know, that's your role. No, it's not. We'll play that role in a future life if we need to. This is all just pretense anyway. So how can you say that we have a set role in pretense? We're not really into seeing how pretense turns out. So we don't need to perpetuate it. We'll let the reptilians deal with them and see how they like it. You know, they probably won't enjoy that either. You know, strange bedfellows, but it will it'll probably cause both of them to repent, you know. Earth women and the reptilians, neither one of them are going to like that too much. That is for sure. I made it very clear from the very beginning. I am not going to accept the blame for this. This is your deal. I'm telling you, don't do it. It's wrong. It's a mistake. You're going to regret it. I'm not going to be here for you to dump on me. It's your problem, your responsibility. I'm not going to fix it by taking blame for it. It's not going to work that way. You have to take responsibility for your choices. But we can't perpetuate this pretense. That's right. Don't need to. We'll worry about it in another life. If we need to choose that, we'll work on perpetuating it in some other life, not this one. Well, you're an anathema to us. Well, okay, I'll be an anathema to you in a future life. We'll work on that whole anathema thing in a future life. You'll never be able to entertain existence again. Well, okay, I'll work on never being able to entertain existence again in a future life. Christians say, put it all on Jesus. That's the one thing the ego doesn't want you to do. Put it all in the grace of God. Put it all in a future life, as I put it. I'll entertain all this stuff down the road at some point. At some point, I might entertain this. I have the option. Possible. I'm not ruling it out. So in other words, put it all on Jesus. He's forgiven us all for all our sins, so he's not judging us at all. So the idea is that he won't throw anything out. He won't say, oh, well, no, you can't do that. He says, look, it's all for all is forgiven. It's no problem. If you want to entertain that later on, you can do so. No fury like a woman without a scapegoat to dump it on. That's right. Sidestep it. Deal with that in another life. That's for sure. We think, oh boy, but boy, I'm in for it bad. Well, we'll be in for it bad in a future life if we want to entertain that. We'll entertain all that stuff in a future life. If we choose to exercise that option. And they say, well, yeah, but the plan was for us to blame you out if it didn't work out. Said, no, that wasn't my plan. In fact, I explicitly said, I'm washing my hands of that. That's the plan of the ambitious. I'm not ambitious like that anymore. That's your own ambition. You got to pay the price for your own ambition. I don't have to pay anyone else's price for that. I've already paid my price for dabbling in ambition. That's enough for me. I've paid enough price. I'm not about to pay anyone else's price. And they say, well, Jesus paid the price for everyone. Well, what he did was, he says, everyone is free to pay the price later, not now. You don't have to pay it now. Do it later if you want to. That gives you opportunity to get used to now. You see how this, the genius of this? It gives us an opportunity to get familiar with now without this pressure of committing to it first, ahead of time. How can we commit to now ahead of time? It's ridiculous. Of course we cannot. But if we have the proviso that this is possibly temporary, and we'll see how it goes, and we're not committing to it. We're just, for right now, this is what we're experiencing. In a distant future life, we might choose something different. Then we're not in the box of feeling we have to commit to it. This gives us this edge that we need, the leverage we need. The humility we need. Because the ambition uses the continuity fear against us and manipulates us through our continuity fear. But if you just say, well, I'm just giving this a trial run, test drive. I'm not committed to buying the now, actually. Then this takes a massive weight off of you. If you think that you have to buy the now and it'll be forever, how can we choose that? It's ridiculous to think we could choose that. Really? With our continuity fear, the familiarity we have, the vast long familiarity we have with pretense, how can we expect ourselves to drop pretense cold turkey this instant and turn away and never go back, never even consider it ever again, and commit eternally to the now? Boom, just like that. It's not practical to believe that this is what we can do and should do. It's not pragmatic at all. It's idealized. We're not dealing with an ideal scenario here. So do not be put into a corner like that, that you're an absolute teacher. The ego will try to pressure us to commit. I want to know what you are. It says, well, I can't really define what I am because I'm not, this is just a trial run for it all based on, you know, see if I can get familiar with it or not. And the ego doesn't like this. It gets very jittery. It says, no, you got to commit. I got to know what I'm up against here. I got to know. And it knows that it's so used to using continuity fear against us. It's so used to that. That's its ally. Continuity fear is the ego's ally. Without that, the ego is powerless. So we can't get rid of continuity fear instantly from a pragmatic standpoint. So we have to account for it somehow. And yet we can't afford not to be in abidance in the now either at this point. So we have to shift the continuity fear issue into the future. Now, once we get used to the abidance in the now, We might very well say, you know what? It wasn't so difficult. I thought it'd be more difficult. This, I really adapted. I really feel natural. This feels very natural to me, and I'm really used to it. So I think I'm going to extend it for even longer period and keep with this. And then later on, you feel like I want to extend it longer and longer and longer. And at some point, way down the road, we may feel like, hey, I don't really need to exercise the option of pretense. I'm just not interested in it at all. I have no interest at all anymore. But we're not predicting that necessarily. And we're not trying to stand on that. We're supposed to be aware of that. We're saying just right now, for right now, this is just a trial run. And it's a very, very good, option to try this out to see how well it works, as far as avoiding this terrible crisis of absurdity and ambition and arrogance. Arrogance, absurdity, and ambition, the three A's, triple A. See how well see if this can compensate us for lack of jumping into ultra ambition. See how we feel about it. Great opportunity. Say the dance of absurdity is expressing itself as a woman in your life, woman, female body. Of course, keep in mind, this world and bodies have absolutely nothing to do with what we are. They tell us nothing about what we are. In fact, they tell us a complete lie about what we are. An absurdity. This has nothing to do with what we are. Complete absurdity. Keep that in mind. Now, we've said that when I'm going to refuse to be scapegoated. Okay. And others will too. And this general idea of men saying, no more scapegoating. We're finished with this absurdity. It's an absurdity. Finished with it. We're not curious how that works out. You may think, well, okay, I'm a woman. I'm fine. No. Because those super ultra ambitious ones, with their plan, as it backfires on them, as they get regrets, as they find some way to wiggle off responsibility for it all, when they don't have men to blame, and it doesn't work, guess who they're going to blame next? The women who decided that they want truth also. That they don't want to keep doing this scheme, this absurdity, of refusing to take responsibility for our choices. The ambitious ones will turn then to next to them and scapegoat them and say, hey, you sabotaged our effort. You tricked us and you helped the men escape. You aided and abetted the enemy, the fall guys. So you're the ones that we're going to punish. You're the reason why we failed. You're the reason why those women will get hammered. And this ultimately goes on and on, as we know. The Soviet Union was a very good example of that, how the Leninists basically ended up destroying themselves. They were running out of who to blame. So they just kept scapegoating one group after the other of their own party. And eventually the only one was left was Lenin in some maximum security prison cell, with food tasters tasting his food to make sure he wasn't poisoned. Yeah, everyone else had been eliminated. Pretty much so, right? That's the truth. So this is what happens. So the women, there are a lot of women who don't know which way to go. They're afraid. They think, wow, if I decide that I also am afraid, I'm tired of absurdity. I'm not really curious about how it turns out. I don't really want to pursue ambition. I don't want to blame men for choices they didn't make. I want to be honest. I want to be liberated from delusion. They're feeling this way. They're also feeling like, whoa, what if I don't make it? You know, that I'm going to get hammered. So maybe it's safer to work with the radical ambitionists, the yoga girls, and convince men that for our sake you need to stay. For our sake. So they end up being the worst, you know, because they, yeah, we're good, we side with you and everything, but it, you know, for our, we don't want to get hammered, we just can't make it, so for our sake, go ahead and do it. Obviously cannot do that either. So the so-called good women may feel the brunt of this. But they're not really good. Because, of course, absurdity divides itself into good absurdity and bad absurdity. That's called duality. From the very get-go, I divided itself into good I and bad I. Good absurdity and bad absurdity. I just stands for absurdity, arrogance, pretense, absurdity. So the game of trying to play it both ways, that will be brought to light also. That's the worst game. So I've been trying to reach these so-called good women, part of my mission, and tell them that, you know, you got to get off of that. Got to get off of that. Neither good nor bad. Repentant. No longer interested in how it turns out. Dropping the ambition. Stop trying to be a superstar that way. Because they're the ones who are really going to feel the teeth of this. Once the men are blamed that it's not enough, then they're going to really get it. Now this will, in the long run, this will be beneficial because they'll say, wow, I've really got to reevaluate what went wrong. I thought I could play it both ways. It backfired on me. And then maybe you remember hearing non-dual teaching. We hope so. Now, I hope that some of these women are going into non-dual teaching, just like the men. I hope they are too. And I hope they're not just using it to convince the men that, hey, don't worry, you know, stay with us, it'll be all right. We understand non-duality, we're sympathetic to all that kind of stuff, but you need to be sympathetic to us too. And then we're trying to play it both ways. I hope they're not doing that. But knowing how it goes here in this world, this is what you'd have to expect. I find very few people in this world are actually really willing to hear the non-dual truth and be shocked by it and absorb it and are really, really dedicated that this is, they really have had it with this world. That's enough. Most end up getting into the spiritual teaching, sort of infiltrating it and sabotaging it subtly to turn it back towards a dualistic message. So to miss the heart of it, to miss the heart of it. They speak about heart, but they miss the heart of it. But they ignore actually experiencing it and really being it. So this is not going to work out either. Not at all. This is the more difficult trap that's been set. That men will think, oh, no, okay, so, you know, everything's okay. Our re-education will be non-dual teaching, and we won't be blamed too much. And you know, they'll be falsely reassured. Falsely reassured. I certainly got a glimpse, experienced it momentarily, an instant, of what Ramana is pointing to and what all the great teachers are pointing to. It's not some technique to quiet the mind, to still the mind. No, it's beyond that. It's just spontaneous, natural abidance being without any technique or effort at all. That's what Longchenpa is pointing to. So I did experience this. And it's just like, yeah, that's what I am. That's reality. That's how it is. So I do trust in what they're saying. And I'm oriented in that direction. Powerful incentive to go in that direction. And to listen to what they say. And Ramana makes some nice distinctions between those who try to, through meditation and effort, attain a stillness of mind, and those who are able to cut through the root entirely and have the, what he calls the I, disappear into the I. And I get what he's saying. I experienced that. It's we shouldn't try to define it too exactly or struggle with that. I mean, it can be defined. I'm sure it can be, to a certain extent. But what's the point when we don't understand what it's referring to, really? I mean, that'll just cause us to struggle. So it's more important to continue to practice full stop in the wow of just agreeing more and more and more and accepting this is true and getting these little glimpses, more and more little glimpses. That's what's really important. Not trying to come up with some definition or explanation for it, as if somehow that's going to seal the deal. That won't seal the deal. It will only cause frustration. It's more like you have to intuit it. We have to intuit it. And as he said, get rid of everything that's not it. Get rid of all the garbage. You don't have to establish truth. Just get rid of everything that's obscuring. And it will be there. Already, it's already there for us. And we'll just be able to then experience it. So we have to lose interest in absurdity, of what the outcome may be. And just keep on applying the pressure, the right kind of pressure. And the glimpse will just come like a flicker, like a sudden, like lightning suddenly happens in the sky. You just walk along, suddenly, whew, lightning lights it all up, like that. Don't try to anticipate results. Don't try to force results. Just keep doing what is the right approach, managing your success on the path, full stop in the wow. Keep allowing real non-dual presence and teaching into your presence. Keep allowing it into your presence. And you know, we can feel the stress of that, the strain of it. Yeah, absolutely it is. It's like, wow. This is very intense. So just keep the intensity going, manage the intensity properly. And keep reminding yourself that, you know, the urgency of the time, pick up the pace, is very urgent. and have a positive faith that you will succeed. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. I've already done it. And feel like it's a done deal. Just keep reinforcing that over and over and over and over, more and more and more and more. Keep in mind, when you don't have eloquence, it's because you're in the wow. So I shift in and out of it, in and out of it. Sometimes I'm just on fire, and other times I'm in the wow. So, worldly success right now doesn't mean spiritual success. I mean, those who are on the spiritual path have spent a lot of their time in the wow. So they might seem lowly and humble most of the time. And other times they might seem to really shine, and then they go lowly and humble again. Because they go back into the wow. They're making great progress towards acceptance, towards losing interest in absurdity. Acceptance of reality, losing interest in absurdity. So they're not always going to be on top of the world. Sometimes I am, and other times I'm in the wow. This is how you have to look at your life. If you're on the path, then accept that you're on the path. If you're on your way, accept it, that this is what you're doing. Embrace it and realize, okay, that this is what I'm doing. This is great. I'm not always going to be this high-profile CEO type who's always making quick decisions, supervising, always on top of everything. No. A lot of times I'm like, I need to take a rest. I've just entertained some amazing idea and recognition that's just absolutely rocked my world and shaken me up. Doesn't understand what it's in for. I have a pretty good idea, but I don't have an idea of the synergistic effect of all these converging trends of you know, just the severity and just and how it plays out. No, I cannot give a complete assessment of that. Nor should I. Should I need, you know, no. But it's in for a rocky road. It's about to get rocked. The world is about to get rocked. Very, very severely rocked. And this could have many levels of meaning. The yoga girls have trained everyone, the world, and along with their associates, that you can keep your mind together by sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Music. So, trained everyone. And materialism. But don't worry. You know, it's just, if you just get expert at those, you know, really know what you're doing, that you'll be fine. You should be fine. If you're not, it's your fault. You know. So people are subconsciously, the whole thing's been set up subconsciously. Now, superficially, everybody's still going along like everything's fine. But if we know from history, just recent history, I mean, look how bananas everybody went in the 70s, the cocaine epidemic in the early 80s. You look back at that era, it's just like, oh my gosh, did we really go through that? People were just absolutely out of their minds on sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And yet, prior to that, they didn't seem to be that way so much. It's a subconscious thing. Superficially, people may seem fine. But it's like Jim Morrison. He was like this clean-cut, all-American military son boy going to USC or UCLA, one of those. And then 6 months later, he was the Lizard King. You know, it's just they flipped from the superficial into the subconscious area where all this stuff was waiting there. All the programming was waiting there. And so many, the whole culture just went nuts. And of course, Nancy Reagan was saying, hey, you can't do this. Just say no to all this stuff. I'm the queen. You know, I'm the queen here of this world, not the reptilians. And people didn't listen to her. A lot of people hated her, as a matter of fact. She was the villainess because she was saying, you know, I'm the queen of this world. I don't want the reptilians here. Behind every successful man is a woman, as they say. This is a very much of a truism. And by successful man, it means a very ambitious man, a man who has really been fired by ambition. Behind every man like that is really a woman, and it's really her ambition that is driving the vehicle. The man is a figurehead. He's tall, handsome, strong, deep voice, nice mannerisms, gives great speeches, great figurehead. It's the woman's ambition that is being acted out by the man. So this is how it is in the world. So that later on, the man could take the blame if things don't go so well. And if things go well, the woman can say, well, I was really the one who was behind it. And the man will say, yeah, that's true. And you know, she can get the praise for it. So Nancy Reagan was the power behind the throne. There's no question about it. It's more significant than Ronald Reagan dying. This was Nancy Reagan was the ambition behind the throne of that time, the Gilded Age, where they were trying to extend this age of American supremacy and good times and just a vibe of America can do no wrong. We are the great savior of the world. Trying to extend that vibe. And of the reptilians. And they said, you know, no, we know what real ambition is here, and you're just not cutting it. You know, you need to be way more ambitious. We're going to get this whole world, you know, wired. And what a terrible, terrible, terrible time it has been. Really. Awful. Just the worst of times. Also the best of times, because we've had to rally. Something about being down, you know, way down, and then having to rally, make a comeback. There's something very great about that. But I wouldn't want to do it again. That's enough fun for now. So, the world can go completely cuckoo. It has done so repeatedly throughout history. Repeatedly. It's about to go cuckoo again. And I've had enough of cuckoo. Really have. So I'm headed for the hills. Metaphorically. Get out of Cuckooville. People have definitely been programmed. I'm an expert at understanding and recognizing this, and it's been the heaviest program. You can't imagine how heavy the programming has been. Subconsciously. Consciously, everyone still has the habits of saying the right things, making the right smiles, but they're slipping up a lot. It's seeping through. The sewage is seeping through the floor. It's like a beautiful hub, and everything's right, but the plumbing is all gone to pieces, and the sewage is coming up through the floor. The lady of the house is still smiling, and like what a beautiful world we live in, this beautiful house, and everything is so immaculately perfect, and there's this stench. And she acts, pretends like there's nothing wrong at all. I say, what's this stench? Huh? I don't smell anything. Everything's fine. I said, yeah, but I'm seeing the sewage come up through the floorboards here. It's like, wow, you got a severe problem. Oh, no. Nothing, no problem at all. What? And then she'll go into a cuckoo dance. And say, I'm sorry, I'm out of here.